So 44% of Amazon sellers said that their businesses performed better than expected because of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Hi everyone, in this video, we're gonna be talking about which categories you should sell in on Amazon. To do so, we're gonna be utilizing the Jungle Scout State of the Seller report, which gives lots of great insights into which categories are most popular for sellers to sell in, which ones are most profitable, and also which ones can be quite difficult to get into, plus a lot more. So make sure you stay tuned to the very end to learn all of these great insights and how you can take advantage of them. Today, I have a special guest with me, Leslie Termelin, who's been with Jungle Scout for about 3 years and helps with promoting our big research projects. She's here today to help us share a lot of these insights. Leslie, thanks for joining.
Hi, glad to be here. Excited to be talking about our new State of the Amazon Seller Report.
Absolutely. There's a lot of great stuff in here. So let's kick things off and dive right in. So to kick things off, Leslie, what is the State of the Seller Report for those that don't know?
Yeah, so this report is an annual study of nearly 5,000 Amazon sellers, including former and aspiring sellers, to look at the overall picture of what it's like to sell on Amazon. We want to know who sellers are, what their business strategies are, and we look into information like sales and profits, major concerns going into 2021, and a whole lot more.
That's really awesome. I know that we've talked about selling on Amazon here at Jungle Scout for a number of years, and we often have talked about it just from our own experience, you know, myself, Greg, and the other sellers here at Jungle Scout, or we talk from the experience of talking to other sellers. But it's really great to have something like this report that has surveyed a large segment of sellers to be able to, you know, get a lot of these really great insights. So I'm excited to dive in more. So let's start by tackling, you know, I think what we all want to know, what are the most popular categories that sellers are selling in?
Yeah, I would love to. So the most popular category by a landslide was home and kitchen, with 40% of sellers selling in this category. Following that, the other top categories were sports and outdoors, toys and games, beauty and personal care, and health, household, and baby care.
Okay, cool. Was there any in that list there that surprised you, or did they all make a lot of sense?
Yeah, it's not surprising that these are the top categories to sell in. These categories have a lower barrier to entry, which is especially crucial to newer sellers.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. There wasn't too many surprises there for me either. You know, when I think of things like home and kitchen, these types of products, they're very high in demand. Everyone uses products in that category and some of the others. They're generally pretty simple type products, easy to source. You know, sometimes products, it can be difficult to find a supplier because it's a bit of an obscure product, but a lot of the products in these categories would be easy to source as well. A lot of the time, they'd also be fairly small and lightweight, not lots and lots of oversized type products. So all in all, those are lots of great things to look for in a product if you're considering selling on Amazon. And that's at least my thoughts on why these are some of the top categories. So Leslie, let's jump to the other end of the scale. I'm really keen to know, what were some of the least popular categories to sell in?
Yeah, so the least popular categories to sell on Amazon are quite different from the most popular. So we have collectible and fine arts, CDs and vinyls, musical instruments, computers, and luggage and travel gear. And all of those have no more than 3% of sellers with products in those categories.
Okay, yeah, those categories also make a lot of sense to me as well. In contrast to the top categories that we just spoke about, these ones, I think you do need a little more prior knowledge of those types of items. And some of them might be a little bit harder to source just because they are perhaps more obscure. And, you know, things like collectibles and fine arts, they're not exactly something that you can just get a generic version of and private label. So that all makes sense to me. So Leslie, as we're talking through all of this data, I'd love to hear How is this useful for current sellers or people that are looking to sell?
Yeah, so people sell in these categories for a reason. So you can get a really good idea of what categories to start considering and which ones not to, particularly if you're just starting out.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Of course, there's always opportunity in any category, no matter which one you go for. But I think it's wise to start with the ones, like you said, there's people are selling in these categories for a reason. So there's no need to reinvent the wheel. And it might be a good starting place by going to some of these categories that are already very popular. So as we're going through this, and to make this as useful as we can for everyone watching, we'll start to make a bit of a product research checklist, okay, based off of the observations that we're seeing. So again, we've talked about this before, but you want to find products that have high demand. So if you think of things like home and kitchen, again, huge demand. People always need those types of products. And then you think of some of these least popular categories. Some of those are quite complicated products. So you want to make sure that you're finding simple products. And you also want to make sure that they're easy to source. And you also want to make sure they're small and lightweight. So we're going to keep adding to this little checklist as we go through. But those are some of the observations I have so far. All right, Leslie, so let's keep exploring some more data points. Let's jump into what were the most profitable categories that the report uncovered?
Yeah, so the most profitable categories that we saw were computers, video games, and handmade.
I think it's really interesting that some of the most profitable categories also tend to be some of the least popular for sellers to actually be selling in. I'm curious, Leslie, what's your thoughts on why this is?
So categories like computers and video games are more complicated and not as simple to private label. Handmade is quite profitable because of the unique nature of the products that you're making. But typically, it takes a lot more work to create these kinds of products. So your profit margin may seem higher, but remember, your effort is part of the investment.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I think personally, when you weigh up some of the difficulties and the extra steps required for creating some of these types of products, I think it makes more sense to go into some of these categories that are a little bit further down that list, but still have really great profit margins and much easier to sell in, like home and kitchen and pet supplies. But I think it is a good note that if you do have the ability to sell these kinds of products, that they are quite profitable. So on the flip side, Leslie, what was the least profitable categories that sellers were selling in? We definitely want to stay away from those.
Yeah, absolutely. The categories that see the smallest profit margins are collectibles and fine arts, musical instruments, and electronics.
All right. Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. Also, you know, a couple of those categories were also in the least popular to sell in. So it makes sense that they kind of go hand in hand. Now, if you're deciding on a category to sell in, then for sure, profitability is definitely an important factor, but you also want to weigh in how much experience is required for you to sell that type of product or in that type of category. We know that some categories are gated or just more challenging to sell in than others. Did the survey uncover any data around that, Leslie?
Yeah, so we did look into that. The categories that require a high level of experience for sellers to be successful selling in are, again, musical instruments, as well as industrial and scientific, tools and home improvement, apps and games, and automotive parts and accessories.
Yeah, a lot of those categories definitely require a high level of knowledge in a particular area. For example, you might struggle to sell automotive parts if you don't have any experience with cars or mechanics. And, you know, you'd likely need to be a musician or some sort of expert in fine musical instruments if you're going to market and sell those on Amazon, which is probably not most people. So these might be some good categories to eliminate off your list if you're trying to figure out where you want to sell. So, Leslie, I think let's pivot a little bit and talk about the different ways that you can sell on Amazon. Of course, there are different sales models when it comes to selling on Amazon. So I'd love to know what we discovered around which ones are most commonly used by sellers.
Yeah, so the most popular sales model Amazon sellers use is private label, which is used by 67% of sellers. After that, plenty of sellers use wholesale, retail or online arbitrage, drop shipping, and then handmade.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. Here at Jungle Scout, we often talk about the private label model, where the biggest benefits of that are getting higher profit margins and more control over your products. The downsides of private label, though, is that it takes more upfront investment to get started. But of course, you can see from the data that a lot of people are utilizing all of these different methods. And I know that there are lots of people out there that have success with all of them. So you definitely can utilize any of these or a combination. But it's interesting to see that private label is the most popular. So now that we've talked about these different sales models, Leslie, do we know if the top categories change very much depending on which model someone has chosen?
Yeah, so we do have that information. And no, you can see that the top categories don't change all that much. There might be a little bit of shuffling from time to time, but home and kitchen remains at the top, as do sports and outdoors and toys and games.
Okay, that's good to know. So you can think about what model makes sense for you if you're considering a business on Amazon. But regardless, most of the top categories that we're discussing today will work well for any of these models. Now, of course, once you've found a product to sell, the next challenge is to get it manufactured. Of course, China has always been the top country to source products from, to my knowledge. So I'm interested to hear whether we got any data on this, you know, whether this is still the case or if we're seeing people shifting to other countries due to the tariffs and some of the other more recent challenges. Do you have any data on this, Leslie?
Yeah, absolutely. So China still remains the number one place to source products for sellers, with 78% of sellers sourcing their products from China. But we have seen an increase in sourcing from the US, India, Taiwan, and Vietnam as well.
Okay. Yeah, it's interesting to know that China is still the top country for manufacturing, but it sounds like it is worth keeping an eye on some of these other countries, as you can still get a lot of products manufactured in some of these other sort of growing countries for manufacturing. Another question that people often ask us is Amazon still a good opportunity in 2021? Of course, over the past year, the world's gone through a lot of unrest and a lot of craziness. And so, of course, that makes people cautious and wondering, you know, where best to put their money and what to invest in and so on. But from what I've seen personally and just read in the news and so on, it actually, you know, in the e-commerce world, at least, it seems that it's actually been booming. But I'm really curious in the survey, Leslie, whether we asked any questions around the impact of COVID-19 and how that might have affected sellers' businesses.
Yeah, we did. And like you said, Lenny, you know, e-commerce was booming in 2020. I think a lot of people that might have been later adopters to shopping online were just kind of forced to this year. So, you know, we saw e-commerce just grow exponentially. And Amazon sellers reaped a lot of those benefits. So 44% of Amazon sellers said that their businesses performed better than expected because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And 51% of sellers said that their sales actually increased during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Okay. Yeah, that's really great evidence that, you know, even through a pandemic, this is a really great business model that has really thrived, like you said. So definitely, we're going to see that, or at least I anticipate that we're going to see that continuing trend throughout 2021, even as things, quote unquote, go back to normal. I anticipate that we're going to see, you know, more and more people shopping online, or like still a higher percentage than perhaps pre-COVID-19 are going to be shopping online. So I definitely think if you're considering a business on Amazon, now is definitely a great time. So Leslie, in that last figure regarding COVID, that's awesome to hear about the 51% increase in sellers' sales. I'm curious, did you ask any questions to sellers about their profitability.
We did, and this is one of my favorite stats from the entire report. Amazon sellers are profitable going into 2021. So 85% of sellers said that they were profitable going into 2021. And 62% of sellers said that their profits actually grew in 2020.
Wow, that is insane. That is that's an amazing figure. 85% of sellers are profitable. That is massive. And then to think that, 62% of sellers actually grew their profits. So, you know, they're, you know, 85% were profitable, but 62% actually had more profit than, I guess, the year before or previously. Those numbers are pretty astounding. I think that's probably going to be my favorite stat as well. So, Leslie, while you've shared some of the really great upsides of COVID-19 and how that's impacted sellers and their sales, I know that in 2020, since the pandemic hit, that it has also caused some challenges for sellers. One of the main ones being that Amazon was just overwhelmed by all the inventory coming in and the amount of stuff that they had to deal with. So they restricted the inventory limits for new sellers. They could only send in 200 units at a time. And then existing sellers also had their inventory capped. And a lot of sellers had to adapt quite a bit and find other places to store their inventory at their houses or 3PLs, that sort of thing. I know even a lot of sellers switched to an FBM model at times in order to fulfill products themselves when they couldn't send it into Amazon. So I'm curious, Leslie, whether the survey uncovered whether people were using FBM or FBA and whether that's perhaps differed to, you know, the years before that.
Yeah. So in this past report, we did see that there was growth within the FBM sales model. So about 9% of Amazon sellers use the FBM sales model only. But then 34% of those sellers use a combination of an FBM and an FBA type of sales method. Like you just said, Lenny, a lot of sellers started using the FBM sales model so that they could still sell on Amazon, even if they weren't able to get their shipments into an Amazon warehouse, like we saw with those inventory freezes back in April.
Yeah, I'm also curious, Leslie, do you know offhand how these percentages compare to the previous year? Like the percentage of people that used FBM previously? Like, I'm assuming that it's increased in 2020.
So looking at the sellers that sold in just the FBM sales model last year, that was about 6%. And this year we're seeing about 9% selling using FBM. So we're seeing about a 3% increase there. And then last year, we saw about 29% using FBA and FBM as a combination sales method. And this year, we're seeing about 34%. So we're seeing about 5% increase there.
That's what I'm hearing a lot of sellers are doing, are using this combination of FBA and FBM. And then another thing related back to the inventory restrictions, even here with our products at Jungle Scout, we've been looking into a 3PL to store a lot of our products, just as the storage fees have also been quite high at Amazon. We found that a lot of these 3PLs will do this FBM fulfillment for you. So you don't really have to do it yourself. You can just send it into these third-party logistics centers and they can fulfill it for you. The other thing that we discovered is that there are even some 3PLs that support seller fulfilled Prime, which means that your product gets all the benefits of a Prime product, but it's not actually fulfilled by Amazon. So that's another great thing to look into. And we actually have a really great blog post on that topic at junglescout.com if you want to check out that. So one thing that people are always asking us at Jungle Scout is, how much money do you need to get started? And it's always been a really tricky question to ask. So I'm curiously hoping we do, but Leslie, do we have any data on that?
Yeah, we do. So the majority of sellers spent less than $5,000 to get started on their Amazon business. And 28% spent less than $1,000. And that includes the cost of products, Amazon fees, storage, and advertising.
Okay, that's really great to know. We usually suggest between $3,000 to $5,000 just as a ballpark figure to give people. So it's nice to hear that the majority of sellers do in fact get started under $5,000. What does surprise me though is that 28% or nearly a third of people got started for under $1,000. That's actually pretty cool. Again, it's not something that I typically recommend because I don't want to set people up for failure, but as the numbers show, it definitely is possible to start for a small amount. Now, another question that we often get is, what price point should I sell at? Did we get any info on that, Leslie?
Yeah, more than half of the products that third-party sellers sell on Amazon cost between $11 and $25, with the medium price point being at $21.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. When we're talking about price point as a, again, another rule of thumb, we often say that you want to be at least $15 or $20, just because the lower your price point, the less profit margins you're going to get. Because if you look at Amazon's fees, part of the fee that they charge you is to pick your product off the shelf and fulfill it. So that might be $2 or $3. But the smaller your sales price is, that $2 or $3 becomes a larger percentage, or takes up a larger percentage of your profits. So, or a larger percentage of your sales price. That's why, you know, it's going to be the same pick and pack fee if you're selling at $20 or $50 or $100. So really the higher the price, the better. But it's good to hear that the median price there does sort of align with what we often recommend here at Jungle Scout. Now, in terms of getting started, whenever we're talking to people that are looking to get started with this opportunity, we always point out that this is not a get-rich-quick scheme. It is going to take a lot of work and there are going to be challenges along the way. I'm curious, Leslie, if the survey dug into any info around the challenges that people faced getting started.
Yeah, we absolutely did. As with starting any business, it can feel daunting at the beginning. So 66% of sellers admit to feeling stuck at some point in their launch process. But the payoff is high because 60% of sellers are profitable within their first year of launching their product on Amazon.
Very interesting. That's a very hopeful note. So for anyone that might initially be daunted by that first number of, you know, two-thirds of sellers feeling stuck at some point in the launch process, just remember that that is totally normal. You're doing something that, you know, you've never done before. And again, this is a real business that is going to, you're going to have to go through a learning curve. You're going to have to be committed. But it's really, really nice to see that almost the same amount, almost two-thirds of sellers are profitable within a year of launching a business on Amazon. Which, if you have any sort of background or knowledge about a brick and mortar business, that's actually pretty unheard of. So becoming profitable within such a short amount of time is actually really awesome. And also considering that a lot of these sellers got started for under $5,000, just kind of goes to show how powerful of a business model this is. Well, Leslie, this has all been super interesting. But I do know that the State of the Seller Report does cover a lot more information. So I'm curious, do you think you could give us a bit of a teaser of what else to expect?
Sure, I can absolutely give you some teasers. So one thing sellers made clear is that they are continuing to invest in their Amazon businesses. We asked about selling in new marketplaces, expanding their product lines, and adding PPC or other marketing investments. And it's clear sellers want to grow and stay competitive in 2021. Of course, we wanted to know what sellers are earning in what categories and what big challenges they're facing. So check out the report to get the full picture.
Absolutely. Thanks for sharing those little teasers, Leslie. As everyone watching, as you've seen from today's video, there are a lot of actionable insights that you can glean if you're considering a business or if you're already selling and you're looking to expand your business, it's really interesting to see what a lot of other sellers are doing and what is working, what's the most popular, least popular, etc. There's a lot that you can glean to help you with your own business. So I highly recommend you check out the report. It's totally free. So make sure you click the link in the description to check that one out. All right, Leslie. So that's going to wrap it up for today. Thank you so much for joining. I really appreciate having you on to share all these insights.
Yeah, thank you so much, Lenny, for having me on. I really enjoyed it.
Awesome. And if you've enjoyed this video, then make sure to give it a big thumbs up below so that we know that you liked it. Also, I want to hear from you guys. Tell me, what's one takeaway that you got from this video? Let me know down in the comments. Again, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video. Take care.